meeting of the Burlington City Council on June 21st, 2016. I'd like to ask everyone to take a moment to silence all electronic devices. For those of you wondering about the assorted dress code, the council is laxing our dress code for the summer, so it's at a whim. So, does that work for you?
That'll work.
For tonight's invocation, we'd like to call on Council Member Bob Ward.
Please join me in a moment of silence as we remember those victims of the Orlando shooting, which occurred on early Sunday morning, June the 12th. Thank you.
This time, Council recognizes City Clerk Renee Ward.
Move to cancel is my responsibility to remind you of your duty to avoid conflicts of interest in matters of course. This time, I ask for any official conflicts concerning tonight's agenda.
No.
None.
This moves us to the approval of minutes. We have minutes from May 23rd, 2016, special City Council meeting, June 1st, work session, and June 2nd, City Council meeting. Do I hear a motion regarding the approval of minutes?
Motion that we approve the minutes of all three.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? So we have the adoption of the agenda. Do I hear a motion regarding the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? For our consent agenda, these items are typically non-controversial. If anyone has any questions, please let us know. Item A. To release a listing of taxes and assessments totaling $309,638.82 for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2016. Item B, to approve an amendment to the Downtown Revitalization Grant Agreement to extend the date of termination to June 30th, 2017, and to authorize the mayor, the city manager, and the director of finance to execute the document. Item C, to approve an agreement between the City of Burlington and the Town of Elon for reciprocal automatic aid, fire protection, and emergency medical technician services. Item D, to approve the extension of the existing 2015-2016 fiscal year agreement between the City of Burlington and the Whitsitt Fire Department, Inc. for fire protection and emergency medical technician services until the opening and operation of Fire Station Number 6. Item E, to approve a new agreement for fiscal year 2016-2017 between the City of Burlington and Whitsitt Fire Department, Inc. for fire protection and emergency medical technician services for beginning from the date of the opening and operation of Fire Station 6 through June 30th, 2017. Item F, to set a date of public hearing for July 19th, 2016, for City Council to consider an economic development incentive agreement pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 158.7.1. Item G, to approve a contract between the City of Burlington and Fern Creek Veterinary Care, PA, for the operation of the Spay and Neuter Clinic of Alamance County, effective July 1st, 2016 to June 30th, 2020. Item H, to approve an agreed-upon procedures engagement with Stout, Stewart, McGowan, and King, LLP, in the amount of $6,500 concerning pension audit, and to authorize the mayor and director of finance to execute the contracts. Item I, budget amendment 2016-33, CDBG reallocation of funds, as spelled out in your agenda. Item J, budget amendment 2016-34, animal services donation, as spelled out in your agenda. Item K, budget amendment 2016-35, appropriate donations, recreation programs, as spelled out in your agenda. Item L, budget amendment 2016-36, recreation, Royal Stadium Playground, Impact Alamance Grant, as spelled out in your agenda. Item M, budget amendment 2016-37, final budget amendment, all funds, as spelled out in your agenda. Do I hear a motion regarding the consent agenda?
So moved.
I hear a second.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? This moves us to our public hearing. Item one, a public hearing has been set to consider a proposed amendment to the City of Burlington Zoning Ordinance Section 32.10.y as it pertains to agricultural sales within residential districts. This time, Council recognizes Amy Nelson, Planning and Economic Development Director.
Good evening, Mayor and Council.
This text amendment originated with a presentation by Mr. Harold Owen at the May 2nd Council work session. The proposal is to allow the sale of fruits and vegetables within city residential districts, an idea that has its roots in the new comprehensive plan. Council agreed the text amendment should go to the Planning and Zoning Commission. The proposed text amendment has the recommendation of staff and the Planning and Zoning Commission voted to recommend the request to council by a vote of 6-1. The commission found that the text amendment will not adversely affect the city and that it is consistent with the comprehensive land use plan. Mr. Harold Owen is here to speak to this request.
If I'd known we had a relaxed dress code, it'd have been in shorts and t-shirts tonight.
You can't see behind here.
Oh, okay. Sorry. As Amy's indicated, this process began at a work session 6 weeks ago. Went to P&Z. It goes back to what we explained then, the concept of offering this opportunity in neighborhoods with rules and regulations to govern it. At the P&Z meeting, it was really good discussion, and something was brought up, and which I think we need to share, was the concept of an application to be filed for anyone who wants to do this that will literally show, number one, the agreement, which was included here, about a contract someone for property. And I think also it would alert to the staff that these particular types of businesses may be interested in coming into a community before it starts. Do I think you're going to be inundated this year? Probably not here. We're talking about in the middle of June. But certainly, hopefully, in the future, you'll get more and more of these opportunities. So, if there's any questions, I'd be glad to try to answer them if I can.
Are there any questions from council?
Mayor, if I could, I'd just like to make a comment, is that I've had some conversation with Richard Parker, and I believe it was another member of P&Z, you know, had mentioned the deal about the application. I think it may be a good idea, but my notion of it wouldn't be anything long and elaborate, but it'd be more, you know, just sort of keep up with how many you have and where they are, you know what I mean, sort of a one-pager, if you will. But, I mean, I think it would be a good idea myself. I just throw that out early on here for discussion.
Obviously, it's part of the text change. The staff is part of this process. We'll certainly look at the compatibility with the neighborhood standards, the following criteria in terms of hours of operation, and the text actually says no more than 6 months of the year, traffic flow and vicinity and overall safety to the neighborhood and the property owners, residents and pedestrians, and also signs for residential sale of plants, fruits, and vegetables shall comply with Section 32-12 of this ordinance. As I can't recall exactly what Section 32-12 says anymore, but it's pretty strict, I can assure you. But I think what we're trying to get to here is the use of common sense again, which sometimes we forget in government. We're trying to give people the effort to indeed do what I think the master long-term plan there is trying to say in the city, be more proactive. But also do it in a way that it will not negatively impact the integrity of any community. And, you know, if we can do that, I think everybody benefits. If someone takes advantage of this and does not do it that way, then I think we've got really good staff that can certainly monitor that, and if we need to, stop it.
Are there other questions from council? Thank you, Mr. Owen. This is a public hearing. If anyone on this side of the room would like to speak. Would anyone on this side of the room like to speak? Thank you. Do I hear any other questions from council? Do I hear a motion to close public hearing?
Second.
All those in favor of closing public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
I make a motion to approve the City of Burlington zoning ordinance. text amendment.
Questions regarding the motion?
I second that.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion as stated to approve, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? Then we will need a motion on statement of consistency.
City Council finds that the zoning text amendment is consistent with the City of Burlington Comprehensive Land Use Plan, and this action is reasonable and in the public interest in that this amendment is compatible with current and land use practices.
All those in favor of the statement of consistency, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? Thank you. Item two is new business. City Council will consider a request to temporarily close Front Street from Lexington Avenue to Spring Street during the 5K fundraising event sponsored by Walker Dance Ballet Theater on Saturday, July 16, 2016, from 6 a.m. until 10 a.m., conditional upon meeting requirements of the City of Burlington's special event permit. At this time, Council recognizes Ann Brady, owner of Walker Dance Ballet Theater. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Ann Brady Sapp, and I am the owner and artistic director of Walker Dance Ballet Theater, located on Front Street across the street from the co-op. We are having a 5K fundraiser run-walk event that will be benefiting Christmas Cheer of Alamance County on July the 16th, 2016. And we would like or are requesting for the streets to be closed, Front Street between Lexington and Spring from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. that day. And I'm here to answer any questions.
Are there any questions from council? Okay. Hearing none, do I hear a motion from council?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? Thank you, Ms. Brady. This moves us to item three. City Council will consider a request to temporarily close Front Street from Main Street to Worth Street during the 5K fundraising event sponsored by Cone Health Cancer Center at Alamance Regional on Saturday, September 24th, 2016, from 6 a.m. until 9 a.m., conditional upon meeting requirements of the City of Burlington's special event permit application. This time, Council recognizes Sean Perkins, representative of Cone Health Cancer Center of Alamance Regional.
Mayor, member of Council, Sean is attending another event. So today we have with us Doris Cardwell from the Cancer Center. Okay. And they do have, one modification to the request to close the street. The race is actually going to take place the same day as Alzheimer's Walk downtown. However, after meeting with public safety, we felt that we should it'd be in the best interest for them to close the street for that part of the morning. Very quickly, once it's the runners are out, they'll run out through Front Street across church, as outlined in the special events packet. But they'll come back around, and they're going to finish this time, instead of finishing downtown with the Alzheimer's event, they're going to finish at First Presbyterian. Is that right, Doris?
Between Presbyterian and Day School.
Okay, so Maple Avenue between Fisher and Davis. They would also like to add that to their proposal so that it alleviates some of the congestion in the downtown area that morning.
Excellent. Welcome.
Thank you. Our event is for Survivorship. It's a community event sponsored by the Cancer Center, Fuller Dental, and some other local businesses. And the purpose of the event is to create a platform to raise awareness for cancer survivorship issues in the community and to raise money for our survivorship fund.
Any questions from council? Do I hear a motion regarding that item?
Move
Make a motion that we approve the request.
Honor the request. Second.
All right. All those in favor of the motion to approve, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? Thank you very much. And is Doris?
Yes.
Thank you, Doris. Item four, City Council will discuss releasing a request for proposals to complete a corridor plan for Maple Avenue. At this time, we recognize Amy Nelson.
Good evening again. As presented to Council at the May 30th work session, you have before you an RFP for a corridor plan for Maple Avenue. Corridor planning has been identified in the comprehensive plan as a vital action for economic development. Improving Burlington's major corridors will have the added benefit of raising the quality of life and even civic pride for all citizens. Since there were two beginning points proposed for this corridor, we decided to put both on the RFP and ask for estimates for each of them. We hope the final result will be a corridor that is beautiful, that functions better from a transportation standpoint, and that is a prime area for economic development and redevelopment. Staff is here to answer any questions you might have.
Questions from council?
So it's going out today, the proposal, if we approve it, it goes out today?
No, I believe it's tomorrow.
The 22nd?
Yeah, it's going out tomorrow, yeah. And then they're going to be due on the 28th.
Okay.
Any other questions?
It follows in our goals, gateways and corridors and the redevelopment areas,
ma'am.
And transportation and land use. So it seems like a good way to get started on that portion of our plan.
This was one of the highest priority corridors as identified,
yes.
Correct?
The highest, yes.
Any other questions from council? Do I hear a motion regarding this proposal?
So move.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of approving the proposal, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? Thank you, Ms. Nelson. Item 5, City Council will consider a request for Burlington Police Department to apply for a community-oriented policing services COPS office grant. This time, Council recognizes Police Chief Jeff Smythe.
Mayor and Council, thank you for a moment of your time to discuss this important matter to the police department. Let me start by saying that the federal government operates on its own cycle and kicks out grant opportunities without much thought about their impact to local governments. So, we managed our budget request process. This came out a good bit after that, just a couple of weeks ago, and so we're responding to their timeline. It's due tomorrow, so it was convenient that we had a council meeting tonight to bring this forward for your review. So that's kind of the timing there. We've done our best to manage the city's obligations across the lifespan of this grant. So we're asking for 6 police officers to be funded in the 16-17 fiscal year. The initial level of that funding is that we would be responsible for 25% of the costs of the personnel, and the federal government would cover 75%. They asked for an increasing commitment from the city across the 3 years of the grant, so we're proposing that we pay for 30% of the personnel costs in the second year, 45% of the personnel costs in the third year. And then in the fourth year, which is 19-20, we would be responsible for 100% of the personnel costs associated with the grant. I believe you each have a spreadsheet that looks like this with the costs across the time span there. If you'll notice on the capital line, for 6 officers, we ultimately have to have 6 vehicles. And what we've proposed to do is space those out over a 3-year period that will utilize some coming offline fairly worn out police cars, but we'll struggle through for another year or so with each of those across this timeline to lessen the fiscal impact to the city. So we're looking at additions to the 16-17 budget of $70,000. That's $38,000 in personnel costs and $31,000 approximately in general fund costs. That's the equipment that the officers will be issued that they'll wear. And then the other costs you can see are pushed forward into the future years of the grant. That I'll answer any questions that you might have.
Questions?
The staff positions that we've added in the last couple of years, refresh my memory on those. None of those were sworn officers this past budget cycle, is that correct?
No, we had two officers that are allocated and geared towards training. So with our new schedule, we've got a good bit of additional available training time at no cost to us. So we're putting staff in place to leverage that and take advantage of that. So last year, the year before, we added some CSIs, crime scene folks, some civilians, a number of commitments across there. But we really are in need of additional sworn staff.
Now, the new officers, if we decide to approve this, would they be totally on the street or would they be doing something different?
Well, so it's a community policing grant, and there's certain niches that you have to fulfill in order to be able to get the grant. And so we looked at operationally how would we deploy them to meet the needs of the citizens and simultaneously meet the needs of the grant. And so we A few years ago, we had a unit called the Community Crime Abatement Team, CCAT, and due to increasing workload, we kind of disbanded that unit and folded those staff back into patrol. And so we're proposing that we reconstitute that unit. So that would be a sergeant and five officers who would be a flexible unit that would be used to address current trends and problems in the community. So, you know, it's the perfect example that we're experiencing now that we're using overtime staff to address the violence problem in our community. And if this grant had been in place and those officers were in place as the CCAT unit, we would simply retask them from whatever they were working on at the time and then have them address the violence issue in our community. So it's a terrifically flexible unit. It's what I would call an industry best practice for agency of our size to have that kind of unit available to task for problem solving, reducing crimes in the community, and protecting the public. So that's how we would propose we deploy these six new officers if we're awarded the grant and if you folks are kind enough to approve that process for us.
Pending the approval, what's the timeline for getting the officers online?
Great question. So we would anticipate ramping up to be able to hire those six people. The likelihood is that they'll have to attend a police academy, so they would start in the academy in January, conclude that academy in June of next year, fulfill the field training requirement of 4 months. So we're really looking at an October of 17 deployment date for the unit.
And the time span on the grant, when does that clock start ticking? Is it when the officers are hired, or?
We have some flexibility to work with the COPS office on that. So it'll be funded in October. And so that works out pretty well for us that we've got that lead-in time. So there might be 3 months where we'll see there's a possibility if we get already sworn officers, we could start them a little more quickly. And occasionally when you can present a case to the COPS office and the DOJ that you've had this lag in hiring people, they'll give you a full three-year cycle from when you hire them. So we'll just see how it works out. That's a negotiated process with the DOJ.
Okay. Excellent. Any other
questions? If for whatever reason we had to reassign these folks that did not align perfectly with the grant, would there be any penalties? We'd have to pay the money back that they'd given us, or would we just have to absorb 100% from that point forward?
Yeah, generally they recognize that city governments and policing is a fairly fluid operation, and so based on the needs of their organization, as long as we continue to fill community policing objectives, and there's some broad applicability for that, there would be no penalty at all, and we might be able to make adjustments without assuming those costs. And that would be certainly scenario A that we would strive for, and then B would be absolutely that we would simply assume full responsibility. We do have, under the terms of the grant, full responsibility for 100% of their salary in year four anyway. So it's just a matter of timing on when we pick that up.
Any other questions from council? Do I hear a motion from council?
I move we approve the request to apply for the grant.
Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion as stated to approve? All those in favor of the motion to approve, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Thank you, Chief.
Thank you very much.
Item six, City Council will discuss appointments to advisory boards and commissions. Council has been furnished with a list of boards and commissions. I'll go through those briefly. To the ABC board, Council will appoint Lisa Kirkpatrick. The Board of Adjustment, Joyce Lane. To Burlington Housing Authority, Patrick Mills, Dorothy Yarborough, and Charles Carter. To Historic Preservation Commission, Lori Bryan, Patricia Durham. Keith Wood. Minimum Housing Commission, Council will appoint Kim Crawford, Mary Bozeman, Rebecca Green, and Sandra Ford. To Planning and Zoning Commission, Richard Parker, Ryan Kirk, and Matthew Dobson. To Recreation and Parks Commission, Risha Drumgold, Galen Brown, and Jacob Wade, and James L. Reed. Traffic Commission, Martha Lipsky, Cindy Parks, Nathan Page. Tree and Appearance Commission, Benjamin Smedberg, Martha Mason, Laura Mann, and Walt Brown. And Public Transportation Commission, Calvetta Watlington. Are there any questions from council regarding this proposed appointment list? Do I hear a motion regarding the appointments?
Move they be appointed.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? This time we move to a staff report on our 2016 retreat action items. At this time, council recognizes City Manager Hardin Watkins.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to go through this fairly quickly this evening. If council members want to stop and have discussion about some of these, please just get my attention and we'll do so. I do want to acknowledge our staff and thank them for being here this evening. You see the same folks that were at our retreat back in January back again this evening in case there are any questions or you'd like some illumination. But I'm going to try to move quickly through these and just give you a quick status report on our action items. These are our action items from our February retreat. So number one was to begin actively promoting the city and its featured properties. We've been working through that, and as you know, there's certain folks designated to work on that. Ultimately, we're going to recommend providing some direction to our new economic development director when that person gets on board. There's a list of various things you can do to advertise. So that item is currently on hold until we get that situation resolved. Number two is to solidify ways to implement target industry reports. We recommend providing that target industry report to the new economic development director for consideration. We have verified what we have is good information, and we'll work on that as that moves forward. Number three is to complete a plan to proceed with staffing the economic development department. As council has been giving you updates along the way, that is probably a couple of weeks away due to some day-to-day matters. I haven't quite fine-tuned and finished that report, but you'll see that in the next couple of weeks, and we'll have some discussion at that time. Probably we'll speak with each of you once I've got that kind of ironed out and ready to go. Number four is to align our Destination Burlington plan goals and parallels with the school system's goals, the county's goals, and Alamance Community College. Again, that's going to be rolled up. Our staff has looked through that. There's some details in your spreadsheet there if you want to see what has happened. Our planning staff has had quite a few conversations and done some analysis. We recommend, again, that'll be rolled up into the Economic Development Director's tasks and coordinating with those various entities, but we have had a good thorough review of those various documents. Number five is the Tucker Street interchange feasibility, and there were three parts to that. The first I'll address is the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy Study. We did learn that a said study had been completed in the past. We participated along with our Piedmont Triad Regional Council of Governments, so we do have that as a completed task that had already been done. And then we're currently, COG is currently doing an updated study, and Ms. Amy Nelson, our planning director, is participating in that. They have a goal of updating that study by 2018-2019, and that is indeed, as I said, a regional study. So we feel good about that particular component of this project. Part two of the Tucker Street interchange feasibility was to complete an informal interchange study. We have had some early discussions and conversation. We've met with Mr. Joe Geigel of Federal Highway Administration, that's the federal agency that dictates whether you can connect up with their interstate or not. We've met with Mike Mills, who's our designated NCDOT representative. Spacing appears to be adequate per Mr. Geigel. We will have to go through the National Environmental Policy Act environmental rules because it is a federal action, which obviously creates quite a bit of work. The current study that we have already completed only looks at ramp terminals. We'll need a mainline analysis to assess the merge areas in the interstate mainline, and it could have some auxiliary lanes as well that may be needed at additional cost. So we're going to recommend some further study and getting some consultants involved with that. Part three was to align the Tucker Street interchange feasibility analysis with our airport strategic plan, and our planning staff have been working closely with Dan Danieli over at the airport on that overall plan. So any questions? That was a three-part. Any questions on that? Item number eight is the North Park Master Plan. That plan is in process. There is a draft being circulated now amongst staff, and you will soon be a presentation. Mr. Laws is in receipt of that. our Recreation and Parks Director, and you'll be getting a presentation at the next available opportunity with that plan. It is very good, has some very solid ideas on that, and many parts of that are fairly quick hitters in terms of feasibility, and the ones that are not, there's a strategy on how to roll that into future cycles of capital funding cycles. Number nine is an abandoned property plan to research and report back regarding demolition options and vacant properties. We've made very good progress in this area. Mr. David Beal has worked on that with City Attorney Huffman and others, but we've made good progress, and some reports will be forthcoming to you. Number 10 is our Community Development Corporation feasibility. We've made good progress on that as well. Ms. Shauna Tillery and our planning department has taken the lead on that. Council has provided a memo from Ms. Tillery back in February, giving you some information and the basics on that. You've had that for your review. So, again, we're making good progress on that, and we'll continue that conversation as appropriate. Number 11 is studies for corridor improvement, beautification, gateway, sign standards, and wayfinding. You just took care of one of the action steps on that, was to authorize moving forward with the Maple Avenue corridor study. So we're very happy about that. That'll be one of our first early indicators and first action steps out of that item. Number 12 is the Indoor Recreation Center for the Western Corridor. We have had some very, very preliminary discussions with property owners in the western side of town about that, very positive conversation, nothing serious at this point. We have determined at the staff level that the next step is to undergo a needs assessment so that we understand the needs of a facility on that side of town. And we are undergoing, Mr. Kirkman is leading that effort, and we will be getting started on preparing a scope of work for a needs assessment to actually work with Recreation Parks on what are the components of that facility and what are the needs, and we want to get some community input and conversation on that. Number 13 is to review innovative approaches to improve affordable housing options, and that's a very complicated thing. In your spreadsheet, you saw there's quite a few notes there. There are lots of things happening in the community that the city is not necessarily driving, but we want to try to support those. Obviously, some of that can be addressed as we do the UDO rewrite process. And I'll shorten that up by saying that review is ongoing and will continue in that area. Number 14 is downtown residential development, promotion, and support. There are a number of efforts underway on this item. One is, again, mentioning the UDO again. As part of that UDO work, specific requirements and specific ideas are being worked into that UDO document. Incentives is something that's always on the table. We've had ongoing conversation about that. As you all know, council had been discussed this in previous occasions, but there's the whole concept of residential market demand, and Ms. Ann Morris and her team continue to keep that at our forefront, that is one of the important things that we need to take a look at. We have had some preliminary conversations with UNC School of Government. They have a group called the Development Finance Initiative, and they have some pretty innovative programs and strategies on helping you get through projects like this that are very large, and helping you sort of understand your market need and understand how to get developers to the table, the old ideas, and how do you get folks that have done really cool projects in other communities to your community. This Development Finance Initiative folks pitch that's exactly what they help you do. So you'll be hearing more about that in the future as well, and we've had some nice conversations with them. Item 15 is sidewalk, greenway, pedestrian infrastructure, and council is aware we've had numerous conversations about that. You had a presentation on greenways at the last work session, and we have agreed to roll together the greenways master plan and bicycle master plan together and get started on that. Ms. Lisa Wolf led you through a conversation about that earlier this month. We'll also work through our UDO process to strengthen our sidewalk requirements for new development so that we won't miss an opportunity as there is new development where our plan calls for sidewalks, so that we'll have fewer gaps, hopefully, to fill in the future through that process. We do expect to get some grant money from the MPO for those master plans. It will not fund all of it, as you recall from the work session, but will fund a nice chunk of it. And then finally, number 16 was to proceed with scope of work and cost estimate for a police department facility needs assessment, and that has that task is underway. We have procured a firm, Stewart Cooper Newell, and they have been authorized to start work on that facility needs assessment, and they are indeed one of the experts in the state of North Carolina, maybe in the southeast, on public safety facilities, and well known around the state. So, and that is underway. So with that, I will pause. If council has questions, I'll ask my colleagues to join in and help.
Any questions from council regarding that report? Thank you, manager, for that report and update. This moves us to city council comments. Just like to note that our next city council meeting will be held July 19th, 2016 at 7 p.m. We'll only have one city council meeting for the month of July. And then also, please join us Friday. It's Fourth Friday in downtown, 5 to 9 p.m. downtown. Looking forward to a good event. Any other council comments?
Could we get a quick update on Link Transit, Mike?
We had, as you know, 1829 went and got it at the office, because I thought you may have. Speaking with the Civitans tonight, Mayor and Council, we had had almost three great weeks of positive ridership. We had roughly about 2,067 last week, but that was without one route included, so that's just a four-route total. So we went from a five-route total of 1829 to a four-route total of 2,067. So we're working on getting that fifth route added in for last week. Again, just positive comments. We're making some safety adjustments, ridership adjustments. Haven't hit any large surprises yet, but people are very grateful, very thankful, and just asking a lot of questions. And that's, again, you allowed the fare free month. They're riding it, asking questions, and learning how they can use it, and we'll start July 1 with that dollar fare. So
paratransit piece is going smooth. And
it is. We had, I think, six trips last week. We've had 14 applications. As you know, it's an application process, but that phone number's up and working. Don't have any issues with that at this time, and they're, you know, TransDev is providing that service, so no questions with that.
Excellent job.
Sure. Yeah. Any other questions?
Thank you. Any other council comments?
It's nice to see that trend going up.
Yeah.
Those numbers getting better. It's great.
Mr. Mayor and Council, pursuant to NCGS 143-318-11A3, I would ask the City Council go into a closed session for the purpose of discussing the settlement of a claim involving the city.
Thanks. Mr. Mayor, Council, I'd also request the Council go into closed session to discuss a personnel matter. That would be pursuant to NCGS 143-318.11A6.
I'd like to make a comment before we go into session here. I was watching TV tonight, and I'm getting back on the violence in our neighborhoods. One of the local cities started a program called Code of Silence. And that's what we're running into now in our communities. Our citizens have a community code of silence where nobody's telling anybody anything, especially the police department. So I ask again to our citizens, please work with our police department. We need to stop the violence. As I said, violence has no boundary. Everybody thinks it's on the east side. I don't live on the east side, but it was a couple blocks. The last one was a couple blocks from my house. So you see what I'm saying here. We all need to participate in this. We need to help our police department out. And without the citizens' help of Burlington, we can't do it. The families are saying, please stop this. So the families are saying, and so now the neighbor says, let's stop this. We need to stop the violence in our city. And again, I call on the citizens to please take part in this, and let's stop this violence. I just don't like living. This is our town, everybody. This is our town. I say that over and over again. And Burlington is dear to my heart, and I want it to be a safe city. But it takes all of us to do it, to be a safe city. You know, there's groups out here that are trying to get together to form groups to say let's stop the violence. If you got a group that want to stop the violence, why don't you all come together, and let's do this as a unit, instead of each individual little group has their own agenda, please come together and let's do this and stop the violence in this community. We have a lovely town here. We aren't going to let people come in here and destroy our town with violence like they're doing. So I ask all of you, please help participate with the police department, and let's stop this stuff. Let's stop it. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. We need a motion to go into closed session.
I'll, based on the request of city manager and city attorney, I'd make a motion that council go into closed session for the purposes of discussing the personnel matter pursuant to NCGS 143-318-11A6. And discuss a settlement claim involving the city pursuant to NCGS 143-318-11A3.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion as stated, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Return. We will return from the closed session to close the meeting.